الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القران الكريم بعد اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن الا وانتم مسلمون اما بعد ان اصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. In the Quran, multiple times over, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about mankind's origin story. He talks about where we came from. And in that story, there's a lot of nuances that I feel like we often forget. That we kind of understand this just as a historical exploration. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us background into who we are. But we don't take a moment to appreciate the nuance in that story. And today, for the beginning part of this khutbah, I want to talk a little bit about our origin story and perhaps some parts of that origin story that we forget and then how that should translate into our lives today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to this group of angels. And right then and there, we should take a moment to reflect on this. Whatever, even in our culture, there's this understanding that angels are this pure creation of Allah. And in our narrative, we understand them to be sinless, completely sinless, that spend their entire existence in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's so many of them that we understand from other narrations that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that around... Prophet says in the heavens, there's this place where angels worship. And 70,000 of them congregate, and then another 75,000 come after they finish, and the same 70,000 angels never come back. Meaning that there's so many angels that are constantly in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sinless, that it is beyond the number that we can forget, count, but even fathom. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing this group of angels, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Baqarah, that remember when your master, Rabb is a very specific name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's actually the first name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we're introduced to when we read this Quran. We say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. And in this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is an implication of intimacy. An implication of closeness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ. Remember when your master, your caretaker, your protector, your Lord, said to the malaika, said to this group of angels, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. That I'm going to make on this earth a successor. Mankind. A group of people who have the responsibility to take care of this planet. A group of people who are coming one after another, after another, after another, for a purpose, but his angels ask him a question. And if you've read a book by Jeffrey Lang, he talks about it. It says, even angels ask. This was a book about when he was struggling through his atheism. He converted to Islam later on in his life. And he said he converted because of this verse. That he had the same question. It would boggle his mind that how terrible human beings are. That they just cause facad and evil and destruction on this planet. How could there be a God? And he sees in this book that even angels are asking, is it قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءَ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّهُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. This group of angels, Allah says to them, I'm going to make mankind. I'm going to make a group of people who are going to succeed each other. And they said, you're going to put someone on this earth, فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا, who's going to cause chaos. وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءَ, and they're going to spill blood. وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ. And we are in a constant state of your remembrance. Why do you need mankind? What service, what purpose are they going to offer? If this is about worship, we're already here. And we're constantly in your state of worship, and you're going to create something. And I'm not asking out of jealousy or asking out of contempt. It's just a genuine question. And it's a fair question. Why would you create something that's just going to cause chaos and spill blood on this earth? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's response is, قَالَ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I know something that which you do not know. And if you're watching this movie play out, this is what they call the plant and the payoff. That there's this little mystery that Allah puts into this film where he says, there's something about mankind that's different. There's something about mankind that's special. There's something about mankind, even though they will make mistakes, even though they will spill blood, even though they will cause chaos, there's something about them that makes them better than even you, who spends your entire existence, not even life, your entire existence. We don't know the span of an angel's life. Your entire existence in worship, but there's something about them that makes them better than you. But that's something I know and you don't know. I know something that you do not know. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to make this creation. And we understand the story goes on where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he created mankind from his own hands. And this is again an example of where we've read this story, maybe we've heard the story, maybe our parents told us the story, but we really don't understand even what that means. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond human comprehension, and we don't even understand his form or his physicality, but it's not about that. Allah is saying that we're so important that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to make us with his own hands. And so many other verses, Allah says, kun fayakun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says he could make all of existence by just saying, kun fayakun, be and it is. Yet we were important enough that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to take out the time, for lack of a better phrase. That we were important enough that Allah says in another verse that it's harder to make all of the heavens and the skies and the earth. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took time out of the day. And again, I don't mean time in our sense. We understand that Allah lives outside the scope of time, but understand the honor that Allah is giving mankind, that he fashioned him with his own hands. That we are a product of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's hands. And then he continues. And we understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put life into Adam alayhi salam. And the first thing Adam alayhi salam does is what? He sneezes. I mean, this moment of pure humanity, almost weakness. Mankind is created, the angels are anticipating, they're wondering, okay, Allah created this new thing, and Allah is the best of creators, and he created something new. Maybe this is a moment of excitement. And the first thing he does is he says, first thing this creation does is he sneezes, and then the words that come out of Adam alayhi salam's mouth, Alhamdulillah, all praises are to Allah. And these are the same words that are the first words of this Quran. After Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. And then what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's first words to mankind? Yarhamukumullah. Allah says, may Allah's mercy be upon you. That is the first words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to us as an existence, to Adam alayhi salam, to mankind, that may Allah's mercy be showered upon you. We have this understanding or this impression that God is an angry God, that God is a tyrannical God, that he punishes and he threatens and he throws into the hellfire. Yet the very first instance of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is an example of love, of intimacy, of honor, and of mercy. And that same trend exists until the end of time. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you and me the opportunity to have a relationship with him. And again, we sometimes, when we talk about Allah, it's this abstract kind of pie in the sky. He's the creator of heaven and earth, and he is what he is, and I don't really understand what that means, but I gotta have some kind of relationship with him because that's what my parents told me to do. I gotta pray 5 times a day, but I don't even know what my prayers are. I gotta do all these things because, you know, I don't wanna go to hell. Yet, if we look at our first example from Allah's perspective, it's an example of honor, intimacy, love, mercy, and the one I want to focus on today is intimacy. That our relationship with Allah, or the opportunity we have to have a relationship with the creators of the heavens and the earth. I mean, for a moment, it's almost a trite statement. Allah is the creator of everything. But if you really think about that for like a moment, then everything in existence is a product of this one creator. Yet you individually are so important that he wants to have a relationship. And not with you, but with you, like individually, specifically. Because there's no one else who could know you as well as Allah knows you, and he wants you to have a relationship with him. So much so that he mandates it upon you. When we think about mandates, we think that they're burdens. But for a second, I want you to imagine the mandates your parents put on you when you were a child. You have to brush your teeth before you go to sleep. Such a simple example. And at that time, it's just another dumb rule that your parents have, and you're going to do it because you want what you want, but you don't get it. They're just annoying. Why are they putting all these rules on me? Who cares about brushing my teeth? But you realize all of these small examples. You have to go to sleep before 9 o'clock because they know, even though when you don't know, that if you don't get your 9 hours of sleep when you're 4 years old, you're going to be grouchy all day. And they make sure that you eat your vegetables before you eat your cookies because they understand that if you eat them in the wrong order, you're never going to eat your vegetables and you're not going to be healthy. They have all these rules they place on you. And when you're a child, they're just dumb rules. But as you grow up, you realize that not only were they better for you, but they were the essence. They're there because they loved you and they wanted to develop good habits in you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need our prayers. Allah says he's ghani. If all of mankind prays or none of mankind prays, do you or me believe that Allah will be different? Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala get like points every time a worshiper worships? So he mandates it on us, just like our parents used to mandate brushing our teeth, or sleeping at 9 o'clock, or eating our vegetable before our cookies, because they understood that they loved us so much that in order for us to develop the habit of doing something that was better for us, they needed to mandate. But how long are we going to worship Allah just because of mandate? How long are we going to say, okay, fine, I'll pray, or I won't even pray. I won't even do what's mandated of me, or I will do it just because it's mandated, when the very essence of that thing was to live in legacy of this one thing, of the relationship between Adam alayhi salam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to talk about three examples of our worship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how we might think about them, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thinks of them. And the first one is, before we come to our salah, we have to come with our wudu. And we come with the understanding of wudu is this thing you do, because if you don't pray, your prayer doesn't count. So you kind of run to the bathroom, or you run to your wudu room, or you kind of take a quick shower, and you say, someone, wipe your hands, wipe your face, because you just got to do it, right? And that's if you pray in the first place, or if I pray in the first place. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talks about this, and he says, وَإِذَا تَوَضَّأَ الْعَبْدُ الْمُسْلِمِ أَوْ الْمُؤْمِنِ فَغَسَلَ وَجْهَهُ خَرَجَ مِنْ وَجْهِهِ كُلُّ خَطِيئَةٍ نَظَرَ إِلَيْهِ بِعَيْنِهِ مَعَ الْمَاءِ أَوْ مَعَ آخِرِ قَطْرِ الْمَاءِ. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that whenever a Muslim abd of Allah, whenever they do wudu or a mu'min and they wash their face, خَرَجَ مِنْ وَجْهِهِ كُلُّ خَطِيئَةٍ, that all of the mistakes and the sins that their eyes laid upon just kind of fall off as the water falls. And as the last drip of water comes out, so does that sin. And in one instance, sin is a way to get away from hellfire. But even that's too formal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in us this, and we've talked about this before, this nafsin lawama, this intuitive guilt concept that we understand when we're doing something wrong, because we feel guilty about it. And it's a beautiful thing. It's almost like when a baby cries, it might be annoying to us, but if a baby didn't cry, we would never recognize that it needs to be fed, or it needs to have a diaper change, or it needs to be doing whatever it needs to be doing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in our hearts and our souls this guilt, almost like litmus test. Your heart's telling you something, and you know that what you did, or what you're about to do, or what you want to do is wrong. But we do it. And we make mistakes, and that's okay. But after we make the mistake, the reality is we have one of two paradigms. We have one paradigm in which we decide, you know what? I don't want to feel that. That like inside thing where it tells me I'm doing the wrong thing. It's too much, so I'm going to rationalize that it's okay. I was mean to that person because he was a punk to me. I cheated on this test because the professor is a jerk anyways, and they're never going to understand how hard it was. That, yeah, I'm downloading illegal movies, but who cares? Hollywood doesn't deserve my money anyways. And slowly we start to remove ourselves from our wrongdoing, not in the action, but in our ability to recognize we're doing the wrong thing altogether, and we just get stuck in sin. But the alternative is, what do? We just live with that guilt? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a mechanism by which to remove that guilt without removing the understanding that it's wrong, and that's tawbah. But in this context, Allah is saying, so many of us, and I know this is something I struggle with too sometimes, is that I think to myself, why should I have a relationship with Allah? Why should I do, why should I pray or fast or whatever other thing I do when I know I'm so sinful? When I fix my sins, when I work that part of my life out, then I'll turn back to Allah, because then I'll be sincere. Allah is saying, listen, we all make mistakes. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, we all make mistakes, but that shouldn't hold you back from having a relationship with Allah, because when you're doing wudu anyways, all of those sins that you used to do, they'll wash away with the water dripping down. That you don't have to rationalize your wrongdoing, but you don't have to live with that guilt, because you can recognize your Rabb, your master, your caretaker, your protector is forgiving them from you. The hadith is long, but it goes on. It says that when they're making wudu, when they wash their face and the last drip falls off, everything that their eyes have seen that was wrong washes away and their sin goes away. And then when they're washing their arms and they're making wudu until the elbows, and we're just thinking it's this mechanical, ritualistic process, as the water is dripping from their elbows, everything that their hand did that was wrong is washing the sins away. And then when they're washing their feet, every part of their, when they're washing their feet up to their ankles, every sin that they've done with their foot, when they walk to the wrong place, maybe they went to the club, maybe they went to a bar, maybe they went to the person's house that they weren't supposed to go to do the wrong thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the hadith says, is that as that water is dripping from you, as the water drips down, so does the sin of every place you walk to. And then it continues. It says, "O ma akhir khata ma hatta yukhriju naqiyan min al-dhunub." Until that person is pure from sin. That all of that guilt you feel, you can put it behind you, because Allah made this process. Not this just this ritualistic process, but this very spiritual process by which you are forgiven for your sins. That you can come to Allah on that mat, recognizing that it's a fresh start. And you get that fresh start every time you come to the mat. And you can make as many mistakes as you want in between those two, not with the understanding that who cares, I'll get forgiven anyways. That's a wrong attitude, but out of weakness, that Allah will forgive your weaknesses forever. As long as you come to Him turning back. قول قولي هذا استغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه انه هو الغفور الرحيم. ان الله والملائكه يصلون على النبي يا ايها الذين امنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى ال محمد كما صليت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم انك حميد مجيد. And now you're standing on that mat and you're about to pray and you've washed the sins, or maybe you've just performed a ritualistic wudu. Maybe it was just something you did because your parents told you to do it, and now you're doing it out of habit, which still has some merit. It still has some merit. My implication here is don't not do it. But it's just so much more when you're doing it, when you understand that it's a reflection of the beautiful, harmonious, loving, merciful, kind relationship that you can individually have with your master, your caretaker, and your protector. And then you start your salah, alhamdulillah, rahman, rahman. Allah. And you can do that. And you can do that 17 times a day. Or you can take a moment and you can say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, and you can reflect on the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that Allah says, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَىٰ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِسْفَيْنِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the Prophet said, Allah said, that I have broken up my prayer, Qasam to Allah, I've broken up prayer between me, bayni wa bayna abdi, and my slave, not my slaves. When you pray, it's not you praying. It's you praying. And it's you praying. And it's a moment for you to have that connection with Allah. And Allah has that connection back with you. The hadith goes on, it says, وَلِعَبْدِ مَا سَأَلَ, and for my abd is whatever he asks or she asks for. فَإِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, that when my slave, when my abd says, الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, Allah responds, حَمَدَنِي عَبْدِ. Allah's sitting with these angels, and he's saying about you, my abd is praised. I doubt any of you are parents, but at least you've seen in a movie, you understand, or as a child you've seen when you've had a recital, or a performance, or a play, or a Quran competition, your parents are sitting in the audience, and they're talking to the parent next to them, who doesn't care about you, the other parent, they're only there for their child, because your recital probably wasn't that good, let's be honest, you were 7 years old. But your parent thinks you're the best ever. They're like, that's my daughter. And the other parent's like, that's good, I'm only here to see, that's my daughter. That's my son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying about you in the heavens, in front of those same angels perhaps, who asked 15,000 years ago, why are you creating mankind? And Allah is saying, that's my abd. Hamadani abd. He worshiped, he praised me. وَإِذْ قَالَ الرَّحْمَنُ الرَّحِيمُ الرَّحْمَنُ الرَّحِيمُ, and when they say, My master, my character, Ar-Rahman, when they say the words Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Athna alayya abdi. That not only did he praise me in a general sense, but he praised my specific qualities because he recognizes that I'm merciful to him, excessively and consistently. وَإِذَا قَالَ مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ, and when he says, مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ, when she says, مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ, قَالَ بَجَّلَنِ عَبْدِي, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that my abd, has recognized my majesty. My servant has glorified me. And then the hadith continues that for every instance that we say something, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala literally responds. And maybe we're not even saying it with khushu'. Maybe we're not saying it with attentiveness, but at least we can recognize that if we don't want this relationship with Allah, that Allah wants this relationship for us, so he mandates it upon us. There's always a juxtaposition between our perception of Allah and who Allah really is. From our understanding that he's evil and angry, we won't say evil, I'm thinking with big guys, he's evil. But we can come to the conclusion based on whatever, maybe our upbringing, maybe our background, that God's angry all the time. That whenever we find instances when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about you and him, it's just characterized by love and intimacy and kindness. And every moment that he gives us to fulfill that or to manifest that relationship, we can take them as moments of ritualistic worship. Just things we do because we have to. Or we can understand that on the other end, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving every single one of those moments as a moment of forgiveness or mercy or intimacy or kindness and uniqueness. That you specifically matter to him, whether you even don't matter to yourself. And maybe you don't even recognize that you're worth something. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recognizes you're worth something. So much so that the angels who are constantly in his worship, he says, yeah, you're cool now, but look at him. Look at her. Now I'll close with the last example, and that's after you finish salah, you can do your dua. You can kind of just do whatever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and when my abd asks you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about me, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ, I am close. And there's grammatical beauty in this where Allah does not say, tell him I'm close. When my Abd asks you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the closest creation to Allah, about me, Allah doesn't say, tell him that I'm close. Allah answers it himself, because he doesn't want us to even think for a second that he could be far. That we even need an intermediary, even if that intermediary is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying, he's amazing. But you can have a relationship with me by yourself, independent or not with through his intermediary, not as him as a proxy. فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ I am close. أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ And when you read the translation, I answer the call of the caller whenever he calls. It just sounds like weird cryptic poetry. But when you look at each instance of a word, there's beauty in it because there's no qualifier. Allah says he answers the call of the caller, not the call of the Muslim, not the call of the mu'min. Not the caller of the person who's good, not the caller of the person who listens to his parents. All of those things are important, but Allah answers the call of any caller. You could be terrible, but you still have a right upon your master, your caretaker, your protector, إِذَا دَعَانِ whenever he calls. That you don't have to call after you finish your prayer. You don't have to call after you finish your day of fast. Those are great opportunities to call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But even when you're in a state of active sin, you still have the right to a relationship with your master, your caretaker, your protector. And you have a right to that relationship individually. That there is no qualifier for you having a relationship with Allah except that you decide to have a relationship with Allah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He allows for us to improve our relationship with Him. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He allows for us to be steadfast with our prayers, be steadfast with our wudu, and be consistent with our dua, and allow for these moments to be real examples where we feel His love, His intimacy, His honor that He gives us. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He forgives us for our sins. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ah, wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinabah, ibad Allah inna Allah ya'muru bil-'adli wal-ihsani wa ita'i dhil-qurba, wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal-munkari wal-baghi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun, udhkuru Allaha yadhkurkum wa ashkuruhu yazidkum, wa ittaqu Allaha ja'alakum makhraja wa aqimus salah.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, ashhadu an